Hello from the Hilltop. Welcome to today's Alumni Career Services webinar sponsored by the Georgetown University Alumni Association. I'm Sarah Smith, Senior Associate Director of Alumni Career Services, and I'll be facilitating today's webinar. I'm so glad to see so many of you on the line joining us for today's session, How to Become a Conscious Leader, presented by GUAA Career Coaching Partner Sharon Podobnik Peterson. As one of our GUAA career coaching partners, Sharon offers discounted coaching services to Georgetown alumni. If you are navigating a career transition, looking for new career opportunities, seeking growth in your current role or organization, or hoping to hone your leadership skills, you should consider meeting with one of our coaching partners. Please visit g.town/GUAA coaches to learn more. Before I turn things over to Sharon to get today's session underway, I'd like to share a few quick webinar tips and reminders. First, this webinar session is being recorded, and the recording will be made available to all registrants within 48 hours of today's broadcast on our Alumni Career Services YouTube channel. Sharon will answer your questions towards the end of her presentation, so please feel free to send in questions and comments for her as you have them using the questions area of the GoToWebinar control panel. And finally, if you're having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via the questions area of the GoToWebinar control panel as well. Without further ado, I'm thrilled to introduce Sharon Podobnik Peterson, founder of the Center for Conscious Leadership and GUAA Career Coaching Partner. Sharon supports exceptional leaders in visioning and realizing a future that others cannot yet see. As an educator, serial entrepreneur, and coach, Sharon is a master at evoking possibility in people, ideas, and organizations, and catalyzing ideas into action. She believes that lasting transformation requires deep reflection, calm power, courageous action, and a willingness to experiment with tiny shifts in being that create dramatic results in the outer world. Sharon works with clients to bring their light to their most powerful and authentic leadership identities and cultivate an embodied, effortless leadership presence that increases confidence, clarity, and the ability to be joyfully and intentionally disruptive. She most enjoys working with highly accomplished individuals and teams who are moved to combat systemic inequality and envision a more just, peaceful, and equitable world. Sharon is a graduate of the Georgetown School of Continuing Studies Leadership Coaching Certificate Program and holds ICF-ACC credentials. Sharon, we are so excited to have you here with us today for today's session, and I'm going to go ahead and turn things over to you now.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I appreciate it. Hello, everyone. Very excited to be with you here today. Whether you are in the East Coast and maybe it's lunchtime, I hope you have your lunch, have some water, have something to keep you hydrated while we're going, or on the West Coast like I am and still nursing your first or second coffee of the day. I'm excited that you're here. I'm very excited that you're here. And I hope that you will get comfortable, grab a notebook, grab some coffee, grab something to keep you engaged, taking notes and keeping track of everything that you're learning here today. I'm gonna be talking about how to be a conscious leader and what that means, what that looks like, how to do it. And so as we are going through today's session, I'm gonna ask you for a few favors. One is to drop a couple things in the chat to let me know how you're doing. Let me know what's on your mind as you're going. Like Sarah said, love any questions that you have, would love any comments as we are moving along, moving forward. And the one question that I'm going to ask you to keep in mind the entire time as we are going through this conversation and through this topic is where you stand in all of this. So where do you recognize yourself in the case studies that we're going to be talking about? Where do you recognize yourself in the discussions, in the topic of consciousness? And so to start us off, I'm going to ask you to drop into the chat to consider for a second, what's preventing you from being a fully conscious leader right now? What is standing in your way? And chances are the first thing that came to your mind right now, your gut instinct, your gut reaction is probably the thing. So I'm gonna ask you to go with that and just drop something in the chat, make a note for yourself while I switch over to the presentation. So I'm gonna turn my camera off in just a second here and make sure that you can see what I am seeing. All right, can we see, Sarah, can we see the how to be a conscious leader background now? You should be able to see the presentation and not me.
Not yet.
Let not me yet.
Let me give you control of the screen just in case. Hang on. There you go.
All righty. How about now?
All right. Give it a try now. There you go. Perfect.
Brilliant. Okay. So you should see my How to Be a Conscious Leader screen and not me. Is that correct?
Yes, that's right.
Fabulous. Okay. So welcome. Thank you again for choosing to be here. I know that our time, energy, and attention are in demand right now and not easy to come by. So I truly appreciate you coming here and being here today. So here is what we are going to be reviewing together. During our time together today, we are going to be talking broadly about conscious leadership. We are going to be defining what consciousness looks like, especially in leadership, through a couple of case studies, the impacts of what it means to be conscious or unconscious as a leader, to determine the difference between what is commonly referred to as internal awareness versus external awareness, and how the coherence of awareness results in authenticity for us as individuals, as employees, as leaders, and quite honestly, just as people. And that by bringing all of this together, we are truly able to live awake. So Sarah has already given a fabulous introduction. Thank you again, Sarah. And for anyone who might have jumped on a couple minutes late, like she said, I am an educator, a serial entrepreneur, and a coach. I've been coaching in various industry now for over a decade, but I obviously didn't start as a coach. I was thrust into my first leadership role in education, actually. I started out as a teacher in my early 20s and learned through a pretty painful trial and error process how to lead. I was pretty, unfortunately, painfully oblivious to just how unconscious I was much of the time and felt perpetually overworked and overwhelmed. There were multiple demands and everything felt urgent, and I really struggled to figure out the best thing to do at any given time. I was struggling to figure out who I was, not just as a leader, but as a human, and how the two work together. And I found myself trying on different leadership hats and styles and hoping that the next one would fit better than the last, while mostly just struggling through the whole process and thinking that I wasn't cut out for leadership. And I know that I'm far from alone in feeling this way. So many of us struggle to figure out who we are and who we want to be as leaders, and then how to show up as that leader that we want to be in a really authentic way. And many of us are struggling to stay present and conscious, especially right now, especially when we're working from home and have the demands of the political climate, of everything that's happening in the world right now, and everything that's happening in our homes. And it's really hard. I just want to acknowledge that it is hard to stay present and to stay conscious right now. So if this is something that you're struggling with, again, you are not alone and you're in the right place. And while there's no arriving necessarily in the world of consciousness, there's no achieving a kind of here where you've arrived and mastered this, it is a process that evolves as we do. And I'm gonna share with you today everything that I have learned about what it looks like to be a conscious leader. And in case credentials matter to you, I have degrees in psychology and sociology. My master's is in education and social change. I earned my leadership coaching certificate from our beloved Georgetown University. And as Sarah said, I am a partner coach, so would love to work with you. I have my ACC credentials and served on the board of the International Coaching Federation in DC. And I'm currently studying management and leadership at Harvard Business School. I am on the faculty of Johns Hopkins University and have published more than 20 self-coaching workbooks. I think that number is closer to 30 as we speak. My contact information is there if you want it. If you want to make sure that we answer some questions that you have, please feel free to be in touch. Love to be in touch and talk about it later. But truly and most importantly, I love possibility. I love evoking possibility. And I am super passionate about creating more consciousness in the world and specifically in leadership, because I believe that that is the path to a more peaceful, just, and equitable world. So a little bit about me. Now, what is conscious leadership? Quite honestly, there is no commonly accepted definition, which feels strange, but true. We summarize it by saying it's our inner life. It is our awareness. It is our awareness about awareness. And truthfully, it's just being alive and awake for the life that we're living. I appreciated what Susan Schneider and Max Velmans had to say in that quote. It is at once the most familiar and most mysterious aspect of our lives that we quite honestly struggle to study. We struggle to get it down. We struggle to nail down exactly what it is and how to do it. But because we are here, I'm going to assume that we have a basic shared understanding about what consciousness means and that it's something that we're all working on together. So during our time together today, I will generally be referring to our ability to pay attention, to attend to things in our world, and therefore make them conscious for ourselves. And as an example of how this plays out, I'm going to issue you a challenge right now in this moment to test your own consciousness, awareness, and attention with this test.
This is an awareness test. How many passes does the team in white make?
Go!
The answer is 13. But did you see the moonwalking bear?
So this is a video that I love, and it doesn't matter how many times I've seen it. If I am counting the basketballs, I'm gonna miss the bear. So check in with yourself right now. What did you notice? What didn't you notice? If you've seen this video before, check in with yourself a little bit differently and ask what you are paying attention to right now and how our awareness and our attention truly impacts our ability to pick up what is happening around us. If you are anything like me, you tend to be so focused on one thing, in this case, the counting of the basketballs, that we miss the bear. We are aware of that which we pay attention to, but our brains are truly limited in our ability to take in input. And so we make decisions, we pay attention selectively. It's just what we do as humans. And so if you're giving, for instance, your attention to this full presentation, there are things that you're going to notice that if we're splitting our attention between the presentation and email and lunch, for instance, and of course, no judgment, I understand that we are busy and you are making time in your day for this, so totally understand. Just know that when we are giving something our partial attention, we are likely to miss the moonwalking bears in our lives, whatever those look like. So after you've checked in with yourself, jotted down something in your notebook around what you are noticing about your own attention right now, what you noticed about this video, we are going to take a look at two quick case studies. First, I'd like you to meet Laura. She's been up since 5 a.m., has had 4 cups of coffee, and didn't take time for lunch. She's on a deadline to approve the quarterly earnings report and is facing big pressure from her manager to get it right or else. She hasn't explained her expectations clearly because she's not super clear either. And now she's frustrated that no one knows how to do their damn job anymore. And without warning, she's done. When have you felt this way? Jot down in your notebook a time when you have felt kind of like Laura does in this moment. Frustrated, overwhelmed, maybe not paying attention to the people around you, maybe not even paying attention to yourself in that moment. And let's compare this with Michelle. Michelle and her team have been working for weeks on a project. She orders the team lunch as they complete their final run through, and Simon calls her out on an inside joke. She's established a light, playful environment and strong relationships, so she's able to be herself, fully enjoy the moment, laugh at herself, and get back to work knowing that she has the respect of the team and will surely make it in on time. Again, check in with yourself. When do you notice that you are conscious? When do you notice that you have the relationships or the ability to respond to what's happening with levity around you? And to be clear, these are not always mutually exclusive states of being. That's not true. They are not permanent states of being. We are not permanently Laura or permanently Michelle. We tend to vacillate between these throughout the day. And so if you find that sometimes you are more like Laura and other times you are more like Michelle, you are not alone. Let's check in with the effects of each of these states of being. So we have Michelle on the left and the effects of consciousness, and Laura on the right and the effects of her unconsciousness. And as we saw in the clips, it is clear who is present and available to the world around them and to themselves and who isn't. And even when we're not throwing papers, we know when we're feeling a little bit more like Laura than Michelle. We're stressed, we're under pressure, and often we let those things get in the way as the only thing we are paying attention to. Again, we have limited attention, and what we are paying attention to might take precedent. So the effects of being consciousness. As we saw, she is emotionally responsive to what's happening around her because she is present to the changes in her own body, her own hunger levels, her own stress and mood. She allows them to be, which we hear oftentimes as feeling your feelings, and she gives them what they need, which allows them to fully run their own course. She's also able to see the changes in other people and read the room because she is in tune with things like mood and stress levels and hunger levels, and therefore able to respond in the present by giving what needs to happen. You're able to act without measuring and deliberating over every move because you are being, you are in the present, you are fully embodied in yourself. She is able to see the possibilities because she's not weighed down by things like unprocessed thoughts and feelings. When you have the time and energy to process them, you find yourself being a little bit more open. You find some levity in the room around you, and that results in an overall coherence and authenticity. People experience you, people perceive as you as being more authentic because you are present in the room. And we know when people are present with us, we know when the person across from us is fully and utterly engaged in us, giving us their undivided time and attention, and we honor it. That is common. We know when people are there for us. And on the flip side, we have the effects of unconsciousness. We had Laura being emotionally reactive because she's ignoring her own signals in her own body. She's forcing down her unwanted feelings and is therefore unaware of the emotions that they're communicating. Eventually, they're gonna bubble up for her, and she's gonna react to them instead of choosing her own response. And because she is so inwardly focused, she's also not able to read the room. She's unaware of the dynamics that are at play in the group, and she's unaware of the experience of others. Because of that, she's frustrated, she's overwhelmed, she feels like everything is another thing to deal with, and she's prone to defensiveness. She has a barrier that she's erected to protect herself from feedback, protect herself from the negative feelings because she's got so much work to do. And no matter how well-intentioned, she's gonna miss that feedback about how she's showing up. Because when we are in this place, we're refusing to be present for all of who we are, all of how we feel. We aren't presenting the fullest expression of our truest selves. And as a result, we are often experienced as untrustworthy or not being genuine. And we can't really put a finger on why. We feel like we're trustworthy. We feel like we're being genuine, but we're not, because we are disconnected, distracted, and unfortunately, sometimes overwhelmed. So today we are going to be focusing on recognizing when we are feeling unconscious and figuring out what we can do to help ourselves to be a little bit more conscious. So I have defined conscious leadership as the practice of living fully awake, present to ourselves and the world around us. I want to start with this first piece, living fully awake and present to ourselves. Internal awareness is commonly broken up into three beings. Oh, bummer, the last image didn't load. And that is a moment right here and now of me responding to the moment, seeing something and being able to respond to it because I am present and here with you. Bummer. So typically these are broken up into mind, body, and that last one should be an image of spirit. It is perfectly ironic that an image of spirit didn't show up because we don't know how to create an image of spirit. Anyway, so when we think of the mind, the body, and the spirit, this is what typically makes up our internal awareness. Conceptual awareness tends to be the thing that we focus on the most, how we make sense of ourselves and others using our mental faculties, using our brain, using the things that we know, the things that we remember, the things that we have determined and decided are our values and beliefs, and the biases that we hold in our minds that have been created for us and sometimes through us. So check in with yourself. What are you aware of thinking right now? Jot that down in your notebook. How are you making sense of what is happening right now? And what are you thinking about yourself? And then embodied awareness. This is what is sensed and felt directly in the body through feeling, touch, all of our senses. And this might look like first noticing a sensation. We might notice that our shoulders are moving up towards our ears. That is a sensation we feel. And then we feel that as tension and describe that feeling as the emotion that is overwhelmed and stressed. So these are all interrelated. Our sensations are felt as feelings, which we then interpret as emotions. And then we tend to give that information over to our brains to decide what to do with it. I'm noticing that I'm hungry. Am I going to honor this or am I going to power through and say, I'm going to get this work done first using my brain? And then incorporeal awareness. So this is anything that we know intangibly. It is something that we cannot touch or point to, but it is a gut instinct. It is a curiosity. It is something that bubbles up for us that we can't exactly point to, but we know that it's there. And this is what is least attended to in Western culture. And so if this is something that you have felt lacking lately, you again are not alone. And check in with yourself in body and the intangibles that you know and see what you are aware of in this moment. What are you aware of in mind? What are you aware of in your body? What are you aware of feeling directly? And what are you aware of in your spirit or your soul right now? Take a second to just jot down a couple of these things for yourself. As I mentioned, in Western culture, we tend to focus on the brain the most and remove some of these other inputs that we were talking about. We tend to remove the inputs of discomfort, of our bellies telling us that something doesn't feel right, which then means that we are left with one major input. And we tend to treat that input, our brain, as the input, as the deciding factor. And in effect, this is treating ourselves a little bit like machines, putting mind over matter and ignoring many of the other cues that we face in our lives. And this isn't by accident. We are taught to do so in schools. We are trained to do this. And so over time, we go to our strengths. We over-identify with the brain and ignore the impacts of this on our bodies and souls. So what does this really look like in practice? We might be exhibiting mind over matter if we are persevering in the face of pain and hunger, tiredness and evidence, refusing to go to bed even though we are exhausted because there is something due tomorrow. This might look like skipping meals because we're dieting. This might look like pushing through when we are facing pain for the sake of something else that our brains have determined is important. This might look like overworking despite stress and anxiety. Our bodies are saying, listen, I'm getting sick, I am tired, and our brains are pushing through. This might look like ignoring boredom, curiosity, and intuition for the sake of a paycheck. And so if you have decided, if your brain has decided that the money is more important than following things like curiosity or ideas that you have, this might be an example of mind over matter. Or allowing shame to prohibit us from being our most creative selves, our most playful selves, our most visible, available, feelings forward, present self, because we are afraid of what people are going to think of us if we show up in that way, which means we are forcing ourselves to be someone that we're not. We are showing up in a way that is not fully and completely ourselves because we have determined with our brains that that is something we should be doing. And ironically, this results in mindlessness. This results in not being mindful, not attending to all the things that we could be attending to, and creating a really coherent self, which also creates distrust, not only with the people around us, but in our own bodies. And so if we are prone to skipping meals because we're dieting, if we are prone to ignoring pain, ignoring stress, we start to distrust our own bodily signals. I know this was very true for me. And I lost most of my hunger signals because I had dieted for so long. And so this is just one way that our bodies and our brains almost sever themselves from each other. We divorce our brains from our bodies to get the work done, to power through, to push through. And so if you are a person who tends to use things like hustle and push through and just make it happen, then this might be a place where you want to spend a little bit more attention, spend a little bit more time for yourself. Because what we're really looking for here is coherence. We want to make sure that our body, mind, and spirit are working together to create our most coherent and authentic selves. Because people see this, really, people can see when there is this harmonious unification of all of the inputs that create a whole. We just show up differently. We're able to fully monitor everything that's happening in our inner world, taking into account the full complexity of all of our inputs, whether we see it as the three that are body, mind, and spirit, or even more if you believe in more points of knowing in our body. I, for one, very much believe that our bodies make thousands upon thousands of decisions. I mean, shoot, it might be millions upon millions of decisions every single second as individual cells are deciding what they need to do, what they need to be repairing. And we, our brains, are unaware of all of these things, all of the decisions that go into digesting our food and processing the stress that's in our body. Our bodies are beyond intelligent. And if we are only focusing on one aspect of our intelligence, then we're not creating the fullest picture of our embodied selves. So I am going to ask us to create an opportunity for us to live a bit more into our most authentic selves by creating the coherence, by creating the unity, by asking us to pay more attention to those feelings, to our bodies, to our spirits and souls when they are speaking to us, quite honestly. And now that we've talked about what it looks like in the internal world, I'm going to ask us to dive into the external. So again, conscious leadership is the practice of living fully awake, present to ourselves and the world around us. So we've talked a little bit about being present to ourselves, body, mind, and soul. And now we are going to talk about the world around us. Interestingly, when people talk about self-awareness, they do divide it into internal and external awareness. But what I find to be fascinating is that the study of external awareness typically focuses on this self-to-others piece. This self-to-others piece is our understanding of how others see us. So, you know, in this moment, self-awareness is not just what's happening on the inside, but it is our understanding of how other people are perceiving us. And typically, these things look like understanding the perceptions that others have about us, the assumptions that others are making, the judgments and the biases that other people hold. Now, in the world of self to others, women and people of color in general are far more aware because we are taught to be, we are trained to be, and we are expected to be. Women, for instance, are very aware of how we dress and what people will think of us based on how we dress. People of color tend to be very aware of the judgments, the snap judgments that people make based on biases. And so while we are maybe not proficient in this or maybe not experts in this, we have much more practice than other folks tend to have in this place, where maybe as a white man, you might not have had to ask yourself this on a daily basis as you're getting ready. Maybe you have, maybe you haven't, but typically speaking, women and people of color have much more practice and much more external awareness in these moments. Now, like I said, the self to others content piece of the puzzle is what folks tend to talk about when they're talking about external awareness. I, on the other hand, find this to be woefully incomplete. It is not just important that we understand the people around us and what they think of us. I think it is crucial that we understand ourselves in context, how we have been created by the context that we live in, and how we relate to the context we live in. So I have added the bottom two components: self in context, which is our place in society and world, not to say that our place is fixed in any way, but that our place is generally accepted based on factors, and that the factors that have created our place have created us. There are power dynamics, there are systems of privilege in this world, and just systems in general that have created the conditions for us to be who we are and feel the way that we do about certain things. And it is an incomplete picture of who we are in this world to ignore the self in the context, to ignore that we are living where we live, in the city that we live in, with the families that we hold, with the friends that we have, with the workplaces that we engage in. All of these things contribute to things like how we feel about ourselves, our belief systems, and our values. And so to understand our self in context is to help us better understand our own systems of belief and values and all of these other things that create really who we are. And then the global and cultural context. This is our understanding of the world in general, beyond our spheres, beyond our communities, to understand the historical situations that we're in, the cultural systems, the political climate. This is especially true right now when the political climate is the way that it is and is evoking such strong feelings and emotions and reactions in us. It is a huge piece of self-awareness to understand how we are reacting and responding to what's happening globally. We understand that we are all interconnected, that we are a global community, but it is only when we truly understand what is happening in the biggest picture that we can also understand how that impacts us. We are both impacted by these systems and impact these systems. And so by understanding the biggest, fullest picture of how history has created the time that we're in and who we are, we're able to gain the biggest view of who we are. Now, why is this important? Actually, I want to pause here because I want you to check in with yourself. And I want to check in with your external awareness in this moment. How are you aware in this moment of how the cultural global context is affecting you? What are you aware of right now in terms of our own privilege, our privilege to be here right now together, our ability to do so because of the systems that have created this, that have brought us, quite honestly, together? And after you check in with yourself, kind of go up the chain. There's an interconnection here between the global and cultural context that has created the systems and the societies that we live in that have fully impacted how others understand us and see us and perceive us, which all impacts how we see ourselves. So it is all interrelated in this way. Okay, so what does it look like when we don't have all of this going for us? We might have a myopic worldview, and by myopic, I mean a narrow-focused tunnel vision where we expect everybody to look the same, act the same, do the same kinds of things, because that maybe is the bubble that we know. We only know what we know, and we only know the perceptions and feelings and experiences that we know. And of course we do. That's all we've got to go on unless we go out of our way to find out new things. And so a myopic worldview says that there is one right and one wrong way to do things. And I have opinions on those. And my way is the right way. And what I think is right is right. And we tend to not have a nuanced, shades of gray kind of understanding about the way the world works. How I see things is how everyone else sees things. And how I feel about me must be how everyone else feels about me, for better or for worse. So if I think I'm great, I assume everyone else thinks I'm great. And if I think I'm not doing a great job right now and I am really sucking at my job, then that must be how everyone else feels too, because we aren't able to look outside of ourselves for this additional feedback to see how other people are doing in this way. When we have a myopic worldview, we're divorced from the greater society and culture. We know, again, only our bubble and the smallest tunnel that we are in. And we might say things like, I don't see color. Because in our world, color blindness, gender blindness, ability blindness might be a preferred way of looking at things. failing to recognize then that there are very real differences in perceptions and lived experiences because of how we show up in this world, because of the systems that have created judgments and biases around who we are in this world. And therefore, we're unable, quite honestly, to see the dynamics, to see the systems that create the conditions that create these judgments, that create these biases in the world around us. What we're really looking for, again, just like with coherence and authenticity in internal, we are looking for integration and connectedness in external awareness. To bring them all together in our understanding means that we are able to understand ourselves as the result of relationships, as the result of how people see us, to understand the many factors beyond what we believe and do, that all of this impacts who we are, how we got to where we are, how we show up, everything that has to do with our being and doing in this world. So I have developed a framework, a picture that expresses this full integration. This is my framework for conscious leadership. And as you can see, on the left side, we're talking about everything that contributes to internal awareness. And on the right-hand side, we have everything that contributes to external awareness. And as you watch the flow of the arrows, you can see that really increased self-awareness is going to start with the integration of mind, body, and soul. What we're talking about here is being able to pick up on the internal cues that we have, to pick up on all of the sensations and signals that our body and mind and soul and all of the inner knowing is sending us, so that we are better able to explore our identity, values, and beliefs, to explore who we are, how we show up, and really who we are in this world, all of which contributes to increased internal self-awareness. And on the right-hand side, when we're talking about the external awareness, we are talking about the consideration for contextual and societal undercurrents, which have created power dynamics, systemic inequality, and intersecting privilege, which then contributes to our increased external awareness. Again, both of these are required for us to be fully conscious leaders. With one, if we only have internal self-awareness, then we tend to be introspective. We might be reflective for the sake of our own selves, missing out on the bigger picture. And if we are only focusing on the external, on things that are happening outside of us, we're missing out on the really rich landscape that is our internal self and being. So what do we do? What does this really mean for practice? What are some strategies here? I am going to recommend that you screenshot this page. Why am I going to recommend this? Because there are several suggestions on here, and you might pick one to focus on right now. Start small, but again, you know yourself. So when you are attending to yourself and conscious of how you operate, you know best. Are you going to benefit most from picking one and jotting it down, listening to all of them, and then checking in to see which one feels best? Or maybe this is a great place to start the integration of mind, body, and soul, and pay attention as I'm going through this and see which one feels great, which one feels like you're something you're super curious about, and follow that one. So again, as we are going through this, ask yourself which one feels like the right starting point for you. With increasing internal awareness, there are several strategies here. The first one, again, is attending to these internal signals, the thoughts, the feelings, the sensations that we have. First and foremost, just paying attention to them, being present for them, asking your body how it feels, asking your body how you think about it, whatever this looks like for you. And then asking yourself what questions in reflections. We tend to ask ourselves why questions. Why am I so angry right now? Why do I feel so stupid? Why? When in reality, the more helpful questions start with what. Studies show that when we ask ourselves questions like, what is making me so angry right now? We come up with clearer answers. What is it that I value right now? What is preventing me from doing the thing that I say I want to do? I say I want to go to the gym, but I obviously have a competing value, a competing belief that is preventing me from doing what I need to be doing. One of my favorite studies of this is one that showed that folks aren't likely to take their medications, not because they don't think it's important, but because they have a competing value that they haven't been able to articulate, preventing them from doing the thing that they need to be doing. This is a great place to start practicing breathing. honestly, paying attention to your breath, your body as the oxygen comes in and out. Practicing Tai Chi, yoga, Qigong, these are all great strategies for integrating the body, the mind, and the soul. And I am a huge fan of writing it out. I do morning pages every single day. And if you're looking for a great, you know, starting point, journaling is a great way to do that. Morning pages are three handwritten, scribbled stream of consciousness pieces of paper that you are welcome to throw away afterwards, but it really just helps to make our thinking and our processing and our feelings visible so that we are better able to attend to them. I am also in love with creating a sitting practice. A sitting practice looks like, guess what it sounds like, sitting, and paying attention to one thing for a given period of time. So that might look like paying attention to nothing but your coffee for 2 minutes. That might look like paying attention to nothing but the bird at your windowsill for 3 minutes or until it flies away. And noticing when you are able to practice being present, noticing when you're able to be present during the sitting practice. Some of us call this meditation. For some of us, this is a very intimidating word and meditation sounds scary. And so sitting practice might be a little bit more conducive. Start by sitting and focusing on just one thing at a time. And it might be focusing on your body, focusing on how your belly is feeling after you have lunch, focusing on what it is you're eating for lunch. And then lastly, obviously I'm biased here because I'm a coach, but I fully believe in working with a coach. I have worked with my own coach for the better part of 10 years as well, and cannot recommend it highly enough in the growth process, quite honestly, whatever your growth process is. But most coaches specialize in the evoking of who we are, of the evoking of consciousness, and supporting us in climbing what we see as the ladder of consciousness to being a fully actualized and realized person. So if that's of interest to you, highly recommend that you reach out. To increase our external awareness, this one can feel a little bit more awkward. One of the reasons is because we really need to acknowledge that we have a limited perspective and worldview, that we only know what it is we know, that we only understand our way of being. And we really need to be willing to not know, to not understand in order to gain increased awareness here. This can also look like eliciting feedback proactively. We might have thought we did a great job, but it's really helpful to ask folks for feedback. And there are structured and unstructured ways of doing this. One of them is a 360 assessment, which really just asks everyone in your 360 world, your peers, your friends, your boss, your direct reports, your family sometimes, to share feedback about how they perceive you, about how you're showing up in their world. I find these to be super enlightening. I love conducting these with clients, especially with folks who are in high leadership positions, because we're always learning more and more about who we are, about how we're showing up, and they're always helpful in helping us to create a more full picture of who we are and how we're showing up. This also means taking a look at our intersecting levels of power and privilege. We all have levels of privilege. We all have intersecting identities that are going to determine just how much privilege we have. And it's important that we are recognizing how those create who we are and how we're showing up. And then attending to and taking interest in the beliefs, values, and identities of others. This is a prime way, truly by just like experiencing the lives of others, by participating in the lives of others, that we can see how other people are experiencing the world around us. And we're able to engage multiple sources for the study of history, power, and culture, especially right now, especially in the availability of so much technology that opens up pretty much the entire world's news sources to us to understand history from multiple perspectives, to understand what it means to exhibit power, to have things be created based on culture, and to really spend time seeking to understand what it is in the world that has created us, what it is in the world that we would like to impact as the conscious leaders that we are. So if you haven't yet, this is your last chance to screenshot the page before I move to the next one. If you're on a Mac, the best way to do this is Shift-Command-4. I forget how to do it on anything that's not a Mac. I apologize. And again, ask yourself, which of these feels like the best starting point for you? Check in with the one that you are most curious by, the one that is intriguing to you, and the one that your body is revolting against right now, the one that your body's like, nope, not interested in that, because chances are those are the two that are going to serve you best right now. The thing that you really want to do and the thing that your body is saying, I don't really know about that because there might be a little fear, and that is okay. Now remember, there is no such thing as arriving or mastering this. It is an ongoing practice, something that we come back to over and over and over again to get better and better and better at over time. And we do this, again, for the sake of a more easeful and conscious existence, not just for ourselves, but for all the people in the world around us. So if you are interested in learning more, I would absolutely love to hear from you. I'd love to work with you. I'd love to work with your team, facilitate a conversation about what this would look like for you, for your organization. I regularly lead group workshops on this, facilitate team coaching on this, and then do one-on-one with leaders, and would welcome the opportunity to connect. Like Sarah said, I have a coach profile on the partner page, so definitely head there, but my email address is also here if you would like to get in touch that way. Definitely recommend giving this page a screenshot too, and after you connect with me on LinkedIn, shoot me an email. Like it says here at the bottom, everyone who reaches out by Friday, close the business, gets a coaching session with me to answer some of the specific questions that you have, any concerns that you have, anything that might be specific to you. There are always ways that we can look at this, look at this framework, see what's going well, see what we might want to try out, experiment with, test, and I'd love to help you with that. And again, you know yourself best. So check in with yourself. What do you need to do to make it happen? Do you need to write it down on your to-do list so that you know it'll happen? Do you need to just exit out of this screen right now and email me right now before you forget? You know yourself best, but this is truly the first step in creating the awareness by asking yourself, checking in with yourself, and then acting on it. Okay, so I am going to stop sharing my screen here again in just a moment. So if you haven't, this is your last chance to take that screenshot. My email address is pretty straightforward. It is Sharon@thecenterforconsciousleadership.com. Would love to hear from you. Would love to see what kind of magic we can make together and what kind of questions we can answer for you. And so, Sarah, I think you have probably been taking a look at our questions right now. Would love to answer whatever questions we have some time for.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Sharon. And all of you, thanks for being such an attentive audience. Any questions you do have, feel free to continue sending those in through the questions area of the GoToWebinar control panel. Sharon, I'll start off with this one, who comes from an attendee that says she's a little shell-shocked from having lost her job due to the COVID pandemic. So kind of feels like she's lost her confidence at work. Any advice for, you know, you gave us this great framework today for applying it specifically to the times we're in now, you know, the unprecedented, really uncertain times we're in now, and especially for folks who have unfortunately lost their jobs due to COVID, you know, how might you change this or any additional points that can be helpful here?
Yeah. First of all, thank you for the question. And I'm sorry. I am so sorry that that happened. I know that this is a truly hard time and I'm really sorry. Now, I would love to get a little bit more information, detail, clarity on this, because I think there's actually kind of a lot of ways that you could look at this depending on what your goals are. If your goals right now are to be more present, I heard you say shell-shocked. If your goals are then to be more present, start with your morning pages. Start by writing down every single thing you're feeling. Start by getting it out on paper, feeling those feelings, letting yourself be shell-shocked. I know a lot of times when there's something really big, really feelings heavy for me, I don't want to feel those things. I want to get to solving the problem. I want to make it better. I want to move on to the next thing. And sometimes that's just not what we need. So if you are in the place of resisting your feelings, start there. Start with feeling the signals around being shell-shocked, writing those down. And if you are in a place of saying, okay, I've lost my job and now I have this opening where I want to reevaluate things, this can also be a great time to reevaluate what's happening for you in your world right now. Did you like your job? I know you lost it. I know that's terrible. I know it sucks. And did you even like it? What was going well? What wasn't going well? And where do you want to go from here? You have this place of being in opportunity when we are in consciousness, when we are in presence, when we are in our embodied selves, we see opportunity. And so this is a place where you can check in with yourself and say, like, hey, do I want to be in this place where I'm looking for new opportunities? Or am I feeling super unconscious right now and nothing good is going to come of it? I'm just feeling really down about it. I'm feeling really crappy about it. And so if you're recognizing that you're in this unconscious place, there's nothing wrong with taking a break, doing some of these sitting practices, and coming back when you're feeling like you're in a little bit of a better place. Some of these are really dependent on how you're feeling, quite honestly. And then if you're looking to figure out the external piece of things, this might look like asking for feedback why you were the one that lost your job. Maybe. Maybe that feels right. Maybe it doesn't. Maybe this is figuring out what conditions created this and how you feel about the conditions that created the necessity of you losing your job for this company. I know this isn't a perfect answer. I know this is not an answer that I can wrap a bow on and send it to you nice and pretty, because when we're dealing with something as complex as our internal awareness, as our self-awareness, as our consciousness, there's not a right answer. The right answer, quite honestly, is what feels right for you in this moment. And so because this probably feels a bit nebulous, if you want to talk through it, please definitely reach out. But to anyone who's feeling shell-shocked right now, to anyone who's feeling the stress of the unprecedented times, this is a great place to write about it, to breathe about it, to create a sitting practice, and really practice some presencing, just like literally for ourselves to be okay.
Great. Thanks for talking us through that. And definitely do recommend following up with Sharon. I'll share her contact information in the follow-up email you all will receive after the session as well. Sharon, another question, and I feel like this ties to the example, one of the examples you've given right at the beginning about the colleague who feels very present, and so she's able to really tune in and be a part of inside jokes and things like that. Is there ever a fear, or like, how can we still strike a balance of becoming too collegial or too chummy with fellow staff and colleagues, and like having those barriers break down? Can you speak to that a little bit? Like, how can apply all this and feel empowered without feeling like we're giving up our position of power, I guess?
Yeah, so this is a great question, and I'm glad that you asked it, because I think it points to a couple of other things and questions that might want to be asked. So I think oftentimes when I'm having conversations with clients about being too collegial, with being too friendly with folks, It begs two real questions. One is, who is the leader that you want to be? And so number one, I would ask you to write out or talk out, like, who do you want to be as a leader, and what does it really look like? Because then you will be able to feel for yourself, to feel into what it looks like to be a conscious leader for yourself. What does it look like to have really great relationships with your people, and where are the lines for you? Because that's when you're going to be able to establish those boundaries. This comes into the exploration of identities, values, and beliefs on the left-hand side over here around, what does it look like to have a professional relationship? For some people, a professional relationship means we don't text. I don't want to hear from you after work. This is a purely work relationship. And for other people, this means we can be the best of friends outside of work, as long as when we get to work, we understand the boundaries, we understand roles and responsibilities, and I have the ability to hold us accountable to it. We have the kind of relationship that means we are able to hold each other accountable to getting the work done. This is a great place for, I think, things like radical candor, which basically says the more that you care about somebody, the more direct you're able to be. And the more that they know you care, the more direct you're able to be, right? And so when you have a really great relationship, you are able to be direct around boundaries and say, that was inappropriate. I think we really need to reflect on our relationship and what it looks like to be colleagues and respectful colleagues, but also have fun here. What does it really look like? And I think that this can also be done directly and indirectly, right? By what we allow, what we let continue. And what I often see happening is that somebody dips a toe over the line. That's not addressed. So we dip two toes over the line, and that's not addressed. And before you know it, it feels completely unprofessional and we don't know how we got here. And the answer is it's usually death by a thousand little tiny baby cuts that weren't addressed in that moment. So check in with yourself. What is it that feels collegial but not too chummy? What is it that in the room, in the external awareness piece of things, what am I able to see in the room that tells me that this is still professional and it's okay? Or there's a line, we've said it, we've crossed it. There are some things that are going to be obvious, right? Like anything that comes into even the arena around sexual harassment are obviously going to be completely off limits. But there's other places where it's much more vague. It's much more gray. Talking about like what you did over the weekend, talking about family. People have very different comforts with that, comfort levels with that. And you, the team leader, the team itself, get to create those dynamics, create those norms for yourself. And so you're really in this moment saying, I am going to consciously create a community culture. I am consciously considering what I want my team culture to be like. And this might be a place to elicit some of that feedback, figure out how people are feeling about it, how it feels for them, and ultimately make the decision around what it should look like and what you want to do about it.
That's great. Thank you so much, Sharon. Really good insights there and great advice. I know we're right at the top of the hour. Folks, if you have any other questions to ask for Sharon, please do feel free to get in touch with her, follow up. Sharon, I'll ask this one if you can stick around for just a minute and have you tackle this one, because I think it's really important and kind of, you know, taps into a lot of what you've been sharing. It's about boundaries. So how should someone whose boundaries have been encroached upon clarify boundaries without excluding whether it's family members or colleagues from future communications? Like, how can we set more effective boundaries for ourselves?
Yes. Oof, this is a good one. And with the holidays coming up, can be even more important. So I think I mentioned radical candor earlier, and I think that this is a great place for it. I think this is another place where our awareness of ourselves and our awareness of others helps us to meet people where they are. So for some people, they are open to this conversation, they are willing to have it, but you know these people better than I do and better than anyone else. And so for me, I know that for some family members, that means I can joke with them about it right there at the dinner table and it's not gonna be a big deal. For other people, I know I need to take them aside later, have a private conversation where I'm pretty strategic about it and I have to lead with things like intent and then content and say, hey, listen, my intention, I love you dearly and really value our relationship. And it's important to me that when you or I are feeling uncomfortable, that we bring it to the table. Are you okay with me bringing something to you right now? Is it all right if I tell you something that's on my mind right now? Generally speaking, the person's gonna say yes, you have the permission, and they're primed to hear what you're about to say. And then you can lead with a little bit more intention and a little bit of the content and say, I really want to make sure that when I'm here at grandma's, at the table, at this meeting, that I feel respected as a human. And I know that your intention is to respect me as a human. And you said this, and this is how I felt about it. And I would like to make sure that moving forward, XYZ happens. And for some folks, this can be really awkward because we're not used to having these kinds of conversations with loved ones, with family members, with close friends even. And this may or may not be the culture that exists in these places. It may or may not be the culture that exists in our workplaces, but we are able to consciously bring the decision, make the decision to create this culture, to live this culture. And by living this way, by bringing it into existence, we are adjusting cultures, quite honestly, with the way that we show up and the way that we facilitate these conversations. I hope that answered your question.
Yeah, that's wonderful. Great way to close out today. Any final words of wisdom for us before we wrap things up?
Oh, honestly, if we take away one thing from today's conversation, it is that our attention is one of our most precious resources, followed by time and energy. And so if we are able to attend to, give attention to that which is most important in our lives, things will start to fall into place. And that starts with knowing where our attention is. So if this is brand new to you and you're even just trying to look for a place to start paying attention to what you're paying attention to.
Awesome. Thank you so much for being with us today, Sharon. This has been such a pleasure. And everyone, thanks for tuning in. Again, this recording will be available on our Alumni Career Services YouTube channel. So look there to watch it again and share it with colleagues and friends and family. Sharon, thank you so much again.
Thank you. I really appreciate it and look forward to speaking with everyone.
Wonderful. Everyone, have a great rest of your day and a good rest of your week. Take care. Hoya Saksa.